Okay, thank you for the introduction, and thanks to the organizers for giving me the opportunity to deliver a talk in this workshop. So I will discuss some new regularity results for viscous Hamilton-Jacobi equations with data in Lebesgue spaces, and then I will try to say something about the application on mean field games. And these are joint works with Marco Cirante from Padova, who introduced this topic in the stationary setting. So in order to say to discuss these arguments, let me start from the very beginning, that is from linear equations. So what is known for the Poisson equation is a result that goes back to Calderon and Sigmund, for that states that if you have for the Poisson equation f in LQ, then you control say u in the second order Sobolev space. The same kind of result actually holds for it equations. I call it parabolic Calderon-Sigmund, and this probably dates back to Ladiseskaya, Solonikova, and Muratseva. And more or less is the same result that states that if you have f in LQ, then you control u in the anisotropic analog of the second order Sobolev space. This is true provided that the initial trace, the initial data belongs to this fractional Sobolev space. This can be seen as a kind of intermediate space among LQ and the second order Sobolev space W2Q. Actually, this result is true. It's true even for more general evolution problems on Banach spaces, where A here is the diffusion operator. And actually, this dates back to the first work was by Lamberton, and this is true provided that say the diffusion operator generates a bounded analytic semigroup on L2 that acts as a contraction in LP. So this is an overview of results for linear problems. And so a natural question is to try to extend these results to nonlinear equation. So the main question here is what happens for quasi-linear problems? This is mainly the equation that Marco discussed. And this is its parabolic analog, where the right-hand side now belongs to a space-time Lebesgue class. Here, the Hamiltonian H is superlinear in the gradient. And the question is under which values of the integrability exponent Q these problems behave like the Poisson in the heat equation. And I will address mainly this parabolic problem. The main motivation comes for sure, as Marco discussed, from mean field games, where this quasi-linear equation is appear in backward form and is coupled with the Fokker-Planck equation. And typically, I will try to discuss at the end the case in which F is a power-like coupling, but the results I will discuss can be useful even for the case of logarithmic nonlinearities. And in the parabolic case, actually the result is mostly open. There are a couple of contributions by Diogo Gomes and collaborators, but the results are only partial with respect to the gradient growth. So this is a first motivation. A second motivation actually comes from say completing the regularity pictures for quasi-linear problems. In the stationary case, what is known is a Lipschitz regularity result for the stationary problem. by Pierre-Louis Lyon, who proved Lipschitz regularity when the right-hand side F is belongs to some LQ space with Q bigger than D, where D here is the dimension of the ambient space, and for every gamma bigger than one. This is a striking result because somehow it tells you that as soon as you are able to control this, this can be regarded as, say, a Poisson equation. So under this regime, we have the same behavior of the linear equation. Now, as Marco widely discussed in his talk, there is a conjecture to deal with the complementary regime, that is when Q is less than or equal to D. And this conjecture, let me repeat this the statement, states a control on the Hamiltonian and on the second order Sobolev space for U in LQ, if and only if Q is strictly bigger than D over gamma prime, where gamma is the conjugate of the growth exponent of the gradient. So the proof was has been recently proposed by myself together with Marco, and this is telling you that under this regime the equation is behaving like the Poisson equation. Now a natural question is if something similar could be true for parabolic problems, and in fact we can do something in that direction. Now let me briefly mention some related results. Probably the first result in case the growth in the gradient is at most natural, so up to gamma equal 2, and the right-hand side F is in LQ, with Q bigger than this magic threshold. Say maximal regularity was proved by Ladizenska and Uraltseva, and actually there are also later refinements by the Myers of Tova and Maugeri up to gamma equal 2 again. In the superquadratic case, there are some older regularity results, even for degenerate problems, with unbounded right-hand side by Cardalieghen, Silvestri, and later by Stokols and Pasteur. And then I mentioned the results by Dio Gomes and collaborators about regularity for time-dependent mean field gains, where the coupling is of power growth, let's say. And in this case, they proved some Lipschitz bounds using the Evans nonlinear adjoint method, and their results hold up to gamma equal 3 and for smooth solutions. So I will first discuss the Lipschitz regularity result, let's say the analog of this result by Pierre-Louis Lyon, and then I will attach this this last part, which is again a work with Marco. So just to give the flavor of what one should expect, if one try to find some say gradient bounds, the idea would be to first try to perform a kind of Lipschitz scaling see what happens at small scales to the equation. So if one sets W equal to this guy, then you see here the parabolic scaling, you see that W solves this PDE, and so let me call G epsilon the scale the right hand side. What happens is that as usual, if you have an unbounded term, an LQ term, you have to see the effect of the scaling under the LQ norm. And what happens is that the LQ norm is preserved precisely when Q is equal to D plus 2. So this is what you should expect. So when Q is bigger than D plus 2, you should expect at least a Lipschitz regularity. And in fact, this is what's going on. Now, Here, as in the paper by Diogo Gomes, we implement this nonlinear adjoint method, which is inspired by a paper by Professor Evans. And so let me give the idea behind the proof of this gradient bound. So as usual, when you try to show some gradient bound, the first idea is to see which is the equation satisfied by, say, some directional derivative. So let's pick some unitary direction psi and take v equal to this guy. And you immediately realize that v solves this linearized equation. So up to now, everything is standard. Now the idea is to introduce an auxiliary problem that I call a joint problem. And this is, if you wish, a Fokker-Planck equation, which is backward in time, which develops a singular terminal data and is driven by this drift. Now, this is precisely the dual of this linearized operator. And now, assuming that everything is smooth, the idea is to, say, multiply this equation by rho, by the adjoint variable, integrate in space and time, to deduce a sort of a representation formula for the gradient. So this is what one obtains using this duality structure. Now you see a sort of representation formula in terms of the data. Now you can do a little bit better because here you can integrate by parts and you realize that if you apply orders inequality, your gradient bound should depend at the end on the LQ norm of the right-hand side and on the Sobolev regularity of the adjoint variable. Now, the main point here is that the gradient regularity of rho depends on the gradient of u through the drift. So this is the main point, but at the end everything works. And the main result you need to prove this Sobolev regularity for the Fokker-Planck equation is this one. So it's a kind of Sobolev regularity in terms of some Lebesgue integrability against the density of the velocity field of the Fokker-Planck equation, having L1 terminal data. And you see here that this integrability exponent Q prime, when gamma is less than or equal to 2, is strictly less than this threshold, which is the dual of d plus 2. So this is very important, and you see here why this exponent pops up. And when gamma is bigger than 2, still we have some Sobolev regularity, but this regularity is deteriorating as gamma grows. Now, this result is proved by a method implemented in a paper by Metafune, Pallara and Randi that uses a duality approach and Calderon-Zygmund regularity. Some results appear also in the paper by Alessio Porretta in more general context, actually, but only for gamma equal 2. So in some sense, these results generalize those ones. And so this is what you need to prove the Sobolev regularity for the Fokker-Planck equation. Now, this is the main result at the end. We deal with the more general equation than those driven by the Laplacian, with superlinear growth in the gradient. And we have the right-hand side f in LQ, with the Q fulfilling these two conditions. And actually, this is a regularizing effect because we start with a continuous initial data. And what we prove is that if you have a continuous weak energy solution to the Hamilton-Jacobi equation, having some a priori integrability condition, I will come back to this in the next slide. Then you become instantaneously Lipschitz continuous for positive times, and you have this regularity estimate. So this is the main result, and we have this additional requirement. And let me comment upon the assumptions. So this integrability condition that we impose is crucial in many senses, because first is crucial to have the well-posedness for the Fokker-Planck equation for the adjoint problem. And this is a so-called Aronson-Serring interpolated condition. And but on the other hand, it is also crucial to have Lipschitz regularity. And in fact, using Bayer counterexamples, so we can prove, we can construct bounded solutions to equations with bounded right-hand side, which fulfill this condition, that are not Lipschitz. So this is a kind of crucial condition, and it is very important. This kind of result allows even to prove maximal regularity, because this condition here can be written when H behaves in this way, can be written in this form, let's say. And starting from this, which is almost optimal, then you prove that U is Lipschitz, and then somehow the equation is linearized, and you have maximal regularity. So this is the first attempt to generalize in the full superlinear regime the result by Lyon. The result is false when Q is less than or equal to D plus 2. This is, I expect to be true even when in the critical threshold you can pass to Lebesgue, to Lorentz scales, and I'm still working on that. Mainly you can see to compare results from a nonlinear potential theory that Marco was mentioning. So let me summarize a little bit the result. So what we have is this picture. So when Q is less than or equal to D plus 2, Lipschitz regularity fails. When Q is bigger than D plus 2 and up to gamma equal 2, we have the same behavior of the heat equation. While when gamma is bigger than 2, we have Lipschitz regularity, but this regularity is deteriorating, and still we have a zone in which we are not able to say too much. So this is the result. Actually, in case of a priori estimates, so when dealing with say strong solutions, so classical solutions, we can improve a little bit the results, coupling the adjoint method with the Bernstein method. And we see here an improved exponent that allows to somehow prove that up to gamma equal 3, we have the same behavior of the heat equation. And still, when gamma is strictly bigger than 3, you have Lipschitz regularity, but still the result is not full. So this is what's going on in the case of Lipschitz regularity. Now, let me pass to discuss the supercritical threshold. So when Q is less than or equal to D plus 2, this can be regarded, if you wish, as a parabolic Lyon's conjecture. What you should expect is that here, if you have this time-dependent Hamilton-Jacobi equation with superlinear growth in the gradient and F is in LQ, then you should expect that the Hamiltonian is in LQ, and U is in the second order Sobolev space, if and only if Q is strictly bigger than D plus 2 over gamma prime. This is the, if you wish, the parabolic analog of the exponent found by Lyon. And so why this exponent became D plus 2? Now, typically, when you pass from elliptic to parabolic problems, you are increasing one dimension, let's say, and typically you have to replace this constant D with D plus 2. The underlying idea is that in parabolic problems, you have this correspondence between, say, one-time derivative and two-space derivatives, and this is why adding one dimension means add two to the exponents. This is okay, a general rule that you can keep in mind. And so, as Marco was discussing, a first way to see why this is the critical threshold to expect maximal regularity is again by scaling the equation. So this is the parabolic analog of the scaling by performed by Marco in the previous talk. But let me justify this regarding, let's say, the equation as a perturbation of the heat equation. So if you treat the Hamiltonian as a perturbation, you can apply maximal EQ regularity to see that somehow you can control U in the second order Sobolev space in terms of these two terms. Actually, here a gamma is missing, but on one side, on the left-hand side, you can apply Sobolev's inequality and to see that you have this embedding. Now, you have again a regularity whenever this exponent is strictly less than this, so whenever you have this inequality. And this, in fact, implies that Q is strictly bigger than our magic threshold. So this is just to heuristically justify what I'm going to present. So the main ideas behind this proof is, in fact, to exploit maximal EQ regularity, or if you wish, Calderon symbol regularity for heat equations. So if you regard the Hamiltonian as a perturbation, you can apply Calderon symbol to see that the normal view in the second order Sobolev space is controlled by these three terms. Here is the initial trace, and this is the first step. Now you have to deal with this Hamiltonian term, this gradient term. Now the first idea is to use Gallardo-Nirenberg inequalities. So when gamma is strictly less than two, you can apply classical Gallardo-Nirenberg inequalities to control this term with the second order derivatives in LQ and the normal view in some L infinity LP space and this is a strategy that was that maybe goes back to Amann and Crandall and was later used by Sovtova and by De Meyer and even by Diogo Gomes in the paper on Midfield Games. And the main point here is that gamma is strictly less than two. So if you control this term with this one and gamma is strictly less than two, you are allowed to apply Young's inequality and you can absorb this term on the left-hand side. So this is the key point. Now the main point is to handle the quadratic and the superquadratic case. So to do this, we apply some refined Gallardo-Nirenberg inequalities. Maybe the first and this inequality involves older norms and probably the first proof of this inequality goes back to Miranda, who didn't provide the optimal threshold, which actually was found by Nirenberg. So when gamma equal two, you can prove that this Hamiltonian term is controlled again by second order derivatives and the norm of U in L infinity in time and C alpha in space and older in space. And you see here that this exponent is strictly less than one. So again, you are allowed to use Young's inequality to absorb this term on the left-hand side here. Now, what happens in the superquadratic regime? Here, again, we use a similar inequality, but we have some constraint on alpha and q. So the main point here is that you need to prove some a priori integral and older estimates for solutions to Hamilton-Jacobi equations. In particular, these older estimates are not known. So this is the main point. Now, to prove integral estimates, we refine a little bit the Evans nonlinear adjoint method. Actually, we provide an NP version of this method that was even used by Diogo Gomes and Pimentel in some works in midfield games. And this result actually provides Sobolev regularity for Fokker-Planck equations when you know some cross integrability of the velocity field against the density when gamma is less than 2. And that allows to go a little bit beyond the threshold that we found in the Lipschitz case. So this is a new result for Fokker-Planck equations. And this allows to prove some integral estimates. So what we can do is that when f is in some Lebesgue space LR, when r is bigger than this threshold, we have, say, supernorm estimates, so we have boundedness. But when r belongs to this range, we can prove that u is in some L-infinity LP space. And this allows to use the previous Gallardo-Nirenberg inequalities and to get the at the end the maximal regularity. This integral and subnorm estimates have been obtained by Diogo Gomes, but they are not sharp. There are even other results in the paper by Cardalia, Gay, Graber, Porret, and Tonon, but in that case they deal with the case of degenerate diffusion. So this is in this case we exploit a lot the diffusion. So this is for integral and supernorm estimates. Let me discuss about older bounds. So what we can prove here is that we can prove this older bound when f is in some Lebesgue space LR when gamma equal 2, this alpha is strictly less than this exponent. When alpha is, when gamma is superquadratic, so when gamma is strictly bigger than 2, then alpha is less than or equal to this threshold. And the explicit expression of these older exponents is crucial. And it does not appear in papers dealing with all the regularity for parabolic Hamilton-Jacobi equations. There are these results that I was mentioning in the first slides, but these are achieved using the Georgi's methods and does not provide somehow these. This characterization of the exponent alpha. And these results are obtained using refining the Evans nonlinear adjoint method. I think is the first result to prove older bounds using this approach. And a slight modification of the proof allows even to prove a regularization effect. That is, you start from continuous initial data, and then you prove that these solutions regularize in space. So this is what I wanted to say about these a priori bounds for solutions to Hamilton-Jacobi equations. And so at the end, this is the result. So in the subquadratic regime, we have, say, a full result. So when gamma is bigger than this distribution and strictly less than 2, then we have this maximal regularity result. I wrote it in the way it appears for heat equations. And let me say that when Q is bigger than D plus 2 over 2, it was a proof appeared in the paper by Gomes. Actually, we go a little bit beyond because this threshold D plus 2 over gamma prime is strictly less than D plus 2 over 2 when you have subquadratic growth. Now, in the quadratic case, this is what's going on. So we can prove the fully odd conjecture when Q is bigger than D plus 2 over 2. Actually, there are some results by Softov and by De Meyer when Q is bigger than or equal to D plus 1. So we improve even those results. And actually, let me say that when gamma equal 2, you have the Hamiltonian growth is precisely quadratic, you have the full transform, and so you can prove it in another way, as Marco discussed in his talk. Then let me pass to consider the superquadratic case. So for strong solutions, these kind of priori estimates, then you prove the maximal regularity result under this restriction, which is somehow imposed by the Gagliardo-Nierenberg inequality. And you see that here, this is not sharp, although the result is completely new for superquadratic problems. And this is crucial to study, smoothness for Mipel games. So, in fact, let me discuss the applications to problems in midfield games. So, as Marco introduced, consider this time-dependent midfield game system with power-like coupling. So you may have these two cases. That is the focusing case in which f of m behaves like m to some power alpha, and from second order estimates you can prove this bound, and in the elliptic case you can use Sobolev's inequality to achieve a better integrability information on the right hand side. But when you deal with time dependent problems, you can still apply Sobolev's inequality only space, I think that this is a work in progress. I think that one can achieve a little bit more applying parabolic Sobolev inequalities. So this is a point that should be clarified. But let me discuss some new results in the focusing case. So when f behaves like minus m to some power alpha. And in this case, one can prove that this control on M in the Lebesgue space L alpha plus 1, when alpha is strictly less than this threshold, this was found by Cirante and Tonon. So let me discuss how our maximal regularity result applies to these problems. So this is the main result we are able to prove. So smoothness of solutions when in the subquadratic case, let's say when alpha is strictly less than this threshold, and in the superquadratic case, we have alpha strictly less than this exponent. Now let me clarify how these exponents arise. So let me mention that in the subquadratic case, for instance, the result was known under an additional restriction on alpha, and the result is by Cirante and Tonon. And actually, the second result is new in the superquadratic regime. So we improve in this way the literature on the subject. Now let me show how to handle this power like case. So f of m here is minus m to some power alpha. Gamma is strictly less than 2, so let me simplify a little bit because we have the full result. So what you know is that using this result, you know that the norm of m in L alpha plus 1 is finite, so it's controlled. And by maximal regularity, so the parabolic version of Lyon's conjecture, you can prove a control of the Hamiltonian in LQ in terms of this right-hand side whenever Q is strictly bigger than this magic threshold. Now, just set Q equal to this number, 1 plus over alpha, to see that you have a control on the Hamiltonian, provided that alpha is strictly less than this exponent. Now, recall that this bound holds whenever alpha is strictly less than this exponent, and in the subquadratic case, this is smaller than this threshold. So at the end, the final restriction is this one, and the key point here is that this maximum regularity is enough to have say boundedness of or all the regularity for the solutions of Fokker-Planck equations. In fact, you see that the drift of the Fokker-Planck equation enjoys this integrability condition. Note that this is the Aronson-Sering zone, let's say, when you have this the drift controlled in this Lebesgue space. And this implies, using Amnach inequality, for instance, that M is space-time order continuous. Then, as soon as you have order continuity, you are done, because you can go back to the, say, Hamilton-Jacob equation, and you can use classical tools to prove smoothness, and then you can bootstrap and get classical regularity, let's say. So this is how things are working. In the superquadratic case, things are, say, similar. You have a non-sharp exponent. And even in the focusing case, things should behave in this way, as Marco discussed. So this part is a work in progress, and we will put on the web the paper soon. So this is the result I would like to discuss. Now, here are some references. These are the three works with Marco I discussed during the talk. And here you find some references. The first one is about Lyon's conjecture. And the other one is are related to the integral Bernstein method that Marco discussed. The first two works are by Pierre-Louis Lyon and Lyon et Lasry. And the second one is for problems with quadratic root and even degenerate by Martino Bardi and Bertam. So that's all for my presentation, and thanks again for the attention.